So, today we are going to discuss the solution of the hydrogen atom problem in case of Dirac equation. Now, for any problem in quantum mechanics, the solutions are usually identified in terms of a set of quantum numbers which are associated with mutually commuting operators. So, the task here is to first identify a set of mutually commuting operators which will be given specific quantum number values, and then a general solution can be expressed in terms of these quantum numbers. The quantum numbers become the eigenvalues of particular operators, and the corresponding wave functions describes the various eigenstates. Now, one of the quantum numbers in all this time independent problem is energy itself, because the Hamiltonian is a constant of motion. And so, the task then is to identify all the operators which commute with the Hamiltonian, and they will give rise to the so called eigenstates which are stationary. That means, they do not evolve in time. It is easy to connect also all the operators which mutually commute with a set of symmetry transformations, because it is a general principle that conserved quantities are associated with symmetries which are exact for that particular problem. And these symmetries are well known in case of hydrogen atom. One symmetry is the time independence of the Hamiltonian, which means the energy is conserved. Other symmetry is a rotational symmetry, which means that the angular momentum is conserved. There is a third symmetry, which is discrete instead of these two continuous symmetries, and that is called parity. And it is generally specified in terms of coordinate transformations, where the vector r goes to minus r while time does not change. And clearly, for a potential which depends only on the coordinate r, generically referred to as a central potential, parity is a symmetry of the problem, and it again has a discrete eigenvalues, and the eigenvalues are rather restricted for the simple reason that if I define a operator for parity p, then applying the operator twice, I come back where I started with the original system, and that means eigenvalues of p are basically plus or minus 1. And we have seen examples of this in conventional mathematical physics. In particular, the spherical harmonics, where the radial part is completely factored out from the function and they depend only on the angular part, and generally denoted by YLM, and the convention is used such that the parity of these objects is minus 1 raised to L. So, this is well known in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. We have to basically generalize this particular transformation in the case of Dirac equation, and an extra feature comes in, and let us tackle that before going back to the hydrogen atom problem. The Dirac equation has a wave function, and we will define a parity transformation such that p acting on some wave functions on r gives a wave function which is psi prime and the new coordinate r prime, and with r prime is equal to minus r. If I want to use this transformation on the wave function, and there will be a corresponding transformation on all the operators as well. So, the new operator O prime is defined as P O P inverse, and in particular in quantum mechanics, these are unitary transformations. We determine the explicit form of P for the Dirac equation by going back to the explicit form of the Hamiltonian and demanding that the Hamiltonian remains form invariant when this particular transformation is applied. So, in particular H Dirac had a structure which is alpha dot p plus beta. Can write a c here to make everything dimensionless, plus in present of potential it will be some function of r. This is for central potential. Now, if we see what happens under this particular transformation, in particular we have to consider what is happens to p h p inverse when h has this explicit form. It is easily seen that under the parity operation, the term which is beta does not change because it does not involve the vector coordinate r anywhere. The term involving phi also does not change because all it has is a magnitude of r and not the direction. And so, under this transformation we must have an operation which commutes with these two terms of the Hamiltonian. So, the structure remains form invariant. On the other hand, under the same transformation, the sign of this vector p, which can be also written as a gradient operator, changes because r prime goes to minus r. And so, the first term flips sign, and then we need an operator p which flips the sign back to its original case if the operator anticommutes with the remaining part which is alpha. And then the Hamiltonian, the total Hamiltonian will become form invariant. So, it remains form invariant provided this operator anti commutes with vector alpha, and we immediately know what that answer is, that p is proportional to the matrix beta, and that immediately now gives a complete specification of the parity transformation in case of Dirac equations, that p acting on psi of r is equal to beta psi of minus r. Sometimes it is also written as a matrix gamma 0, which is the same as definition of beta, and this transformation now has both the components of the parity transformation built in. One is the change of the space time coordinate, and another is a change in the internal degrees of freedom, where the matrix beta or gamma 0 acts. And it is obviously true that p square brings back the wave function to where we started with, as it necessary. And if the state is such that it is an eigenvalue of the parity operator, the p times psi will also become equal to plus or minus psi, depending on the sign of parity. Sometimes one writes a more general transformation, which is e raised to phi gamma 0 is used for the particular operator. The reason being that because the phase of psi is unobservable. So, in case of hydrogen atom problem, we have a central potential, and the state should be also labeled by eigenvalue of parity. And so, now we are going to look for a mutually commuting set of operators which can be given eigenvalues. So, eigenstates are specified by eigenvalues, which can also be referred to as quantum numbers. Of the mutually commuting set of operators, which so far we have constructed, are the Hamiltonian J square and J z. They are followed by the same logic as the conventional angular momentum properties in non-relativistic quantum mechanics and parity as well. It could be that there are more set of quantum numbers in addition to this, and we have to figure out if that is the case, but at least these ones should exist. And there is something which we can infer from the known property of how J is constructed. So, J is obtained as L plus S, and that from the analogy with non-relativistic quantum mechanics will tell you that adding the rules of angular momenta, the eigenvalues will be J will be L plus or minus half, where L is the eigenvalue of orbital angular momentum and half refers to the eigenvalue of the spin. I mean, the interesting part is that one can have two possible way of constructing J when you add this two components of the angular momentum. So, same J can be obtained from two states of L corresponding to opposite parity, because the two values of L which correspond to the same j, one is j plus half, the other is j minus half, they differ by 1 unit of angular momentum. If the parity happens to be minus 1 raised to L, they will have opposite parity. So, for every value of j, we expect two states of parity, and they will be determined by this angular momentum addition, and in some sense they mean whether the orbital and the spin part are parallel or antiparallel. They refer to this plus minus sign, and we need to quantify that behavior a little bit better. And we will have to construct an explicit operator which signifies this parallel or antiparallel addition of the angular momentum. So, L and S can be parallel or antiparallel. We have seen already that L and S are not separately conserved in relativistic quantum mechanics, but it turns out that whether they are parallel or antiparallel still makes sense, and that is because of the property that the parity turns out to be a good quantum number, and we will then be able to associate a particular quantity which designates this two kind of additions between L and S. Now, before constructing an explicit operator which specifies this addition, it is useful to go back and look at the Dirac equation itself, because that operator should emerge from the structure of the Dirac equation itself, and we know that that operator will specify whether L and S are parallel or antiparallel. So, we want a general solution. So, we separate the Dirac wave function into radial and angular parts, that is dictated completely by the symmetries of the problem, and so psi will be written as some functions on radius and some other functions on the angles. And we then separately determine the eigenvalues for the radial part and those for the angular part. Now, the separation of the Hamiltonian operator is trivial for the rest mass term as well as the potential, because they are either constants or depend only on the radial coordinate. The angular coordinate explicitly appears only into the alpha dot p part or the corresponding gradient operator. And so, we need to rewrite alpha dot p not in terms of Cartesian coordinates, but in terms of these spherical polar coordinates, where the radial and angular dependent is separated. So, alpha dot p needs to be rewritten in polar coordinates. the earlier expressions we have seen for alpha dot p were all written in Cartesian coordinates, where the things were easy. Constructing it in spherical polar coordinates requires a little bit of trickery, but it can be done in a rather straightforward manner. And we will see how angular momentum kind of naturally appears in this formulation. And so, to be able to do this, I want to construct a kind of triple product of these alpha matrices. And evaluate this triple product in two different ways. If you combine these first two factors, then the algebraic relations between alpha mean the product of two alpha matrices, the only the symmetric part contributes, and so this combination, which gives rise to a term which is R square alpha dot p. If I combine these two parts. On the other hand, I can choose to combine the second two factors, and that produces a term where the first one alpha dot r remains what it is, but the second one is now the combination between r and p, where both the symmetric part and the antisymmetric part contribute, and that will give r dotted with p plus I. The antisymmetric part of two products of alpha we have seen before gives the matrix known as sigma, the spin matrix, and then the antisymmetry converts this r and p into a cross product. And both ways of evaluating this must equal, so that is why this expression equals what is on the other side. And now we will rewrite this object by simplifying things which we already know, and alpha dot r I will just rewrite as r times the radial component of alpha. R is just the magnitude, and the unit vector gives a radial component of alpha r, and this now can be rewritten in terms of various derivatives, in particular this p has a usual gradient expansion. So, this will give minus I h cross r times del by del r, and the second part is I sigma dotted with L. So, we have indeed now separated alpha dot p into a radial derivative operator and the one which involves the angular part, where the angular momentum explicitly appears. Now, it is convenient to choose a slightly different operator than this r d by d r term, so that that operator is Hermitian, and we will define that operator p r, which is not the literally the radial component of p, but it is defined as so that it is explicitly Hermitian. It is unit vector r with p, but to make Hermitian part we will add the opposite order of p and r also. It is different than the radial component of the gradient, because this p acts on this r piece as well, and one can explicitly evaluate these objects, and it comes out to be gradient plus a little bit more, and that extra term is just 1 over r. And this structure is quite common in radial coordinates involving various kind of operators, Laplacian, gradient, etcetera, and in this particular case it can be rewritten as derivative 1 by r d by dr r, and then whatever object it acts on. So, this is a operator p r which we constructed by hand, and then now we can rewrite this alpha dot p rather explicitly. As various factors of r can be removed in a straightforward manner. So, it is alpha r p r plus the alpha r is actually a common factor. So, let me enclose this whole thing inside brackets. And then I by r sigma dotted with L, and then this little bit extra correction gives a contribution which is h cross. So, this now becomes the crucial decomposition which can be used to separate radial and angular coordinates, and we see the pattern of spin and orbital part explicitly appearing in this operator. Sigma dot L is indeed an operator which, as I have said before, can tell us whether the spin is parallel to L or it is antiparallel to L. And this particular operator now we can analyze in a little more detail to figure out what its eigenvalues are and whether it can serve as a additional object for which a quantum number can be specified. So, now let us rewrite this operator in different ways. Sigma dot L plus h cross. It is equal to, well, L has always been written in the units of angular momentum in my notation. So, I can rewrite as a sum of L plus s whole thing square minus L square minus s square. So, j happens to be equal to L plus h cross by 2 times sigma in this notation. And so, this object can be rewritten as by squaring this equation and picking out the cross terms as sigma dot L. And so, it is j square plus h cross square by 4. The eigenvalue of s square is s times s plus 1, which happens to be half multiplied by 3 half or equal to 3 fourth. That 3 fourth comes with a negative sign, and combined with this h cross, it leaves behind this 1 fourth h cross square, and then l square is subtracted as coming from the same equation. And so, now we can plug in the various eigenvalues. So, this object is j times j plus 1 plus a quarter minus L times L plus 1. And this has two different values depending on whether j is equal to L plus half or L minus half. And so, we can list them explicitly. So, this thing has equal to L plus 1, which also is J plus half for J is equal to L plus half, just a straightforward algebra. And when J is equal to L minus half, this quantity is happens to be minus L, or it can be also written as minus of J plus half. So, this object indeed reduces to a sign once you pick a fixed value of J, and the sign will be either plus or minus, and the magnitude will be J plus half. One can now see this behavior also in a little different ways, and that is to consider the square of this operator as well. So, one can look at sigma dot L plus h cross whole thing square, can evaluate this thing without reducing directly to the non-relativistic algebra, but just completing the square of all these quantities. So, it is sigma dot L square plus 2 h cross sigma dot L plus h cross square, and one can use now the algebra of this spin matrices. So, the symmetric part of this thing gives L dot L, and the anti-symmetric part contributes L cross L. One should remember that this object in angular momentum algebra is not 0, unlike classical vectors. And this produces the anti-commutator, which can be rewritten as I h cross L as well. And then one can complete addition and cancellation. The something cancels between the second and the third term, and it can be now rewritten as h cross sigma dot L plus h cross square, which can be now rewritten as L plus h cross by 2 sigma whole thing square plus h cross square by 4. Remember that the sigma square happens to be 3. So, this indeed is back to the expression for angular momentum which we had, which is J square plus h cross square by 4. And now, if you put the eigenvalue of J square, which is J times J plus 1, this can be written as a complete square. So, the eigenvalues indeed are J plus half square times h cross square. So, the operator has the necessary property, its eigenvalue depends on J, it gives a particular sign when depending on whether sigma and L are parallel or anti-parallel. So, it will tell us how to interpret in terms of parity conventions, and in addition to that, because of this particular structure, it is easy to see that this particular object commutes with the total angular momentum. The reason is rather trivial, h cross does not play any role in the commutation, but sigma dot L can be written in terms of all this J square and L square, and we know already from study of non-relativistic quantum mechanics that J will commute with J square, L square, S square, all those particular quantities. It can have simultaneous eigenvalues together with eigenvalues of J. The only remaining part which has to be seen is that does this operator commute with the Hamiltonian as well. And it turns out that one has to add a little more caveat to make it commute with the Hamiltonian without spoiling all the angular momentum property. And that caveat is that the operator which is defined as not the same quantity, but the same object multiply by this overall factor beta, it commutes with H. Now, beta is a diagonal matrix and it does not do anything with sigma or the angular momentum. Sigma also happens to be a diagonal matrix. So, writing it in front or back does not matter, and it does not spoil any of the relations about angular momentum eigenvalues which we just derived. In particular, once one can square k, and then beta square just happens to be equal to 1. So, the eigenvalues of k square are just the same quantities which one can now label by this objects k is equal to plus or minus j plus half, and one can now consider its all values. J, the minimum value is half, and so this series starts as all positive and negative integers, but it can never take value 0. So, this is a operator, and we want to now check it out whether the factor beta does indeed make it commute with the Hamiltonian. It is a straightforward calculation. Again, the terms in the Hamiltonian, the rest mass which has a beta operator itself, it commutes with all this stuff. The potential part also commutes with all this stuff, because the potential does not have any angular dependence. So, the L operator does not do anything, and it has a trivial identity structure in the internal space. So, the only part which is necessary to check out is the commutator of these objects with the first term in the Hamiltonian, which is alpha dot p. And one can easily now evaluate that what is the commutator. So, that object is alpha dotted with p and commutator with beta times sigma dot l plus h cross. We want to check whether this thing indeed is 0 or not, and that now can be easily evaluated by writing these products. And two identities between these matrices are helpful when things are written in different order. One of them is a product of alpha and sigma. So, that gives a general relation alpha I times sigma j. Both of them have polymatrices buried inside it, and if you explicitly evaluate it, only the non-trivial part which survives is this antisymmetric term sigma I sigma j. It lands up on the off diagonal part, and the diagonal part does not contribute in this particular expression. In general, it can. the other object which is necessary is alpha is going to anticommute with beta. So, once you write this expression completely, we get a term which because of the epsilon symbol here will have a structure which is P cross product with L plus the opposite order will have L cross P. And these two terms, the opposite order come because of the anticommutator, but the sign flips because of this alpha and beta anticommuting with itself, and the cross product results from the fact that when alpha and sigma are multiplied together, we get this epsilon ijk symbol. Now, this object can be easily evaluated from the fact that L is just R cross P, and a non-trivial term arises when the gradient sitting inside this momentum operator acts on the R, which is sitting inside the angular momentum operator, and the identity is that this object results in 2 I H cross P, and once these things are put together, it is a straightforward enough exercise to see that this commutator is indeed 0, and so one can give explicit eigenvalues to the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian with values of k. So, now we can go back. We have obtained a set of operators, determined their particular eigenvalues, and the equation now is easily written down in terms of the radial part as well as the angular part. The angular part is going to be eigenstates of this sigma dot L operator, and we will treat that later. And the radial part now I can write explicitly in terms of the operator structure we have determined. Remember that the operator which appeared was sigma dot L plus H, and we can rewrite it as beta times k, and k has a specific eigenvalue. The beta factor survives explicitly, and the potential is all there, and now we have a explicit equation for the radial part of the Hamiltonian which determines the energy of the problem, and where we have seen this P r is the operator involving derivative with respect to r, but rewritten in terms of a form where it is explicitly Hermitian. So, we will solve this equation first to determine the energy eigenvalues, and then we will go back to construct the angular part of the wave function. Now, to solve this object, we need to pick a specific representation for these matrices alpha r and beta, and as well as some multi-component form for the radial part. One can use the ordinary Dirac basis, but it is slightly more convenient and saves some notation to choose a alternative basis, and then one can go back by a transformation to the Dirac basis. So, instead of 4 matrices which are there in the original equation, we only have 2 matrices alpha r and beta, and one can rewrite them as 2 by 2 form instead of a 4 by 4 form, and later we will expand those 2 by 2 forms in terms of the spin components which come from the angular part of the wave function. So, simpler 2x2 structure can be used, and in that notation we will write this wave function as 1 over r times an upper and lower component. The matrix beta we will not touch from its form in the Dirac case, and that will help us in separating the positive and the negative energy components, or equivalently the particle and the antiparticle labels, but alpha we will choose in a clever way to make this equation look simple. And that constraint is that alpha has to be Hermitian and it has to anticommute with beta, and to get rid of these factors of I appearing all over the place, once inside here and another I appears when p is written as a gradient. So, it is convenient to take alpha to be imaginary, which with the anticommutation rule with beta, it is a second polymatrix which can be used for alpha r. And now, this equation can be written explicitly in terms of a two component equation, or equivalently two coupled equations, and the convention chosen is that only real variables are left inside the explicit structures. So, there are now two first order coupled equations which happen to be all with real coefficients, and their structure is by just explicitly expanding the various components. The only difference between this two terms comes from the fact that the upper and lower components are distinguished by the signs of the beta matrix, and that beta matrix appears with the rest mass as well as this derivative. And now, to solve these equations, one has to bring in the whole powerful machinery of solving partial differential equations with certain kind of boundary conditions. It is a straightforward exercise in mathematical physics, and the solutions are linear combinations of what are known as confluent hypergeometric functions. These are the well known functions which come from solving differential equations, which have certain kind of regular singularities at specific points. So, these have so called regular singularities at the coordinates r equal to 0 and infinity, and they are easily constructed, and also one can find explicit formula of these functions in different domains for small value of r, for large value of r, even an explicit form as a power series, etcetera. And we can write that those explicit solution, but it is also worthwhile to just work out what these solutions are step by step. And the method to do that, the first thing is to investigate this asymptotic behavior near both these points. One is r equal to 0 and the other is r equal to infinity. It turns out that it is easy to see the behavior at r equal to infinity from this equation. Both the potential z square by r as well as this last term involving k over r drop out once we take the large r limit, and what is left is just e minus m c square and e plus m c square in this coefficient, and the gradient components is identical, and one can just substitute now f from one equation into the other and reduces the whole thing into a second order equation with the overall coefficient is now the product of e minus m c square and e plus m c square. So, the solutions are rather straightforward. For r going to infinity is z square by r and k by r drop out, and the solutions can be written as e raised to minus rho with rho equal to square root of m square c raised to 4 minus e square by h cross k. So that r goes to 0 as r goes to infinity. So, this is the boundary condition which we impose for bound states, that the wave function vanishes at infinity, and in that case there are two solutions, e raised to plus rho and e raised to minus rho, and by explicit choice we have put in the exponentially decaying solution. Yes, this rho is actually scaled value of the radial coordinate, it is this number which comes from the coefficient of the equation multiplied by r. And now, having done this separation, we can simplify the equation by factoring out this explicit behavior. Which is f of rho is and then by substituting back into this form, we have a somewhat reduced equation which I can rewrite explicitly as where I have introduced this fine structure constant to save some writing of E square over H cross C. And now these equations have a behavior which has to be consistent with the small r behavior of the wave function determined from the physical condition that the wave function should not blow up, so that it is no longer integrable at r equal to 0. And we have to keep that in mind. R equal to infinity part is separated explicitly, and this now have to be solved as near r going to 0 by what is known as a power series method, alternative name is a Frobenius method, and we will do that in the next lecture.